All right, hello everyone, and welcome back to the Pump House's series of artist talks. I'm Olivia, the gallery coordinator here at the Pump House, and today I am joined by Lydia Hansen, whose current exhibition, Sensory Sculpture Garden, is on display in our Kader Gallery through November 2nd, 2024. Thank you for joining me, Lydia.
Thanks for having me.
Of course. Why don't we start with you giving us a background of your experience in the arts?
Sure. So actually my experience in art started with writing. For the longest time, I was just an artist in terms of writing. I did a lot of creative nonfiction writing. I did a writing about my family. I did a lot of journalism as well. I went to school in St. Paul for a BFA in creative writing. And when COVID hit, my life kind of took a curveball. It got really hard to continue writing. It got really hard to continue talking about things and verbally processing things that felt really painful and immediate. I was dealing with a lot of depression, anxiety. I was dealing with a lot of loneliness at that time. And I burned out really hard, specifically at my journalism job. But started looking for different outlets to like feel like I was being creative without feeling like I had to talk about what was going on in my life. I've been crocheting since I was 12, and I've been making little stuffed animals since I was 18. So I've been crocheting for a long time, but it was always something that I thought of as like this side hobby that I have that I make a little bit of cash on the side with by going to a couple of farmers markets every year. And that's all there is. And when COVID hit, and when I was in lockdown, and then when I moved back from where I was living in Northwest Iowa for a year doing journalism, when I moved back to where I live now in Rochester, Minnesota, which is near where I grew up, I was like, you know, this hobby that I've had on the side that I really enjoy, I wonder if I could do something more with it, if I could put some of my creative energy into that instead. And make that my creative outlet instead. And that's kind of where the whole push to do art kind of came from. And I began to transition. The more I worked on that, the more I started consigning at different storefronts, the more I started networking with other artists in Rochester, the more I started like connecting with that kind of artist community versus the writer community, the more I started to see like, oh, okay, yeah, actually what I am doing is art, and I have ideas that have to do with fine art more than I have to do with running a business, or then I have to do with expressing myself through writing. And so probably like in the last 2 or 3 years is kind of where my internal dialogue kind of made the shift to saying, actually, I am an artist. I am a fine arts practitioner, creator.
Do you feel like your history in writing and storytelling impacts any of your visual artwork?
Not really. Not really. Because I think to me, it feels like such different sides of my brain. And such, I mean, yes, so it feels like such different parts of my brain, and it feels like such different parts of my experience as well that I'm talking about. Writing always felt super personal. Like I could always feel like the presence of myself in it very strongly, even if it was stuff for work. Even if it was journalism that I was doing work, you know, that's not the goal. But I always felt the presence of myself as the writer in it very strongly. And when I started doing more art, I can tell like this is art that's very distinct and unique to me. These are passions that I have, these are interests I have. But the ideas that I'm following are always coming from a starting point of where can I connect to something bigger that exists in the world? And then where can I just like explore that something bigger that I don't know anything about? So to me, it just feels like two different terms of creativity, two different ways of looking at the world. And for me, the fiber art side has always been about here's something I'm curious about that I don't know anything about or I don't know very much about, and I want to explore it through art.
Great, wonderful. Thank you for that background. Could you discuss your specific inspiration for the pieces that are in the show?
So the idea for making these came about in like two parts. The first part was a big international art project called the Crochet Coral Reef, which was started by two female mathematicians who were also crocheters. And I don't remember exactly which year this began, but it's been going on for like nearly a decade, perhaps more. And it was all based on a discovery that these two mathematicians made, which was that although it's very hard to graph a hyperbolic curve, which is a curve that continues to expand, you can replicate that very, very easily in crochet. I mean, in this image here of one of my sculptures, I have hyperbolic shapes all over that. It's just that ever expanding rippling pattern. And through being able to replicate that pattern through crochet, it unlocked some mathematical cool discoveries, but also they saw this connection between that shape and coral reefs and began this big project, this big collaborative project making crochet coral reefs. And there's little satellite reefs in different museums and different galleries that have shown around the world. There's a variety of different like traveling exhibitions that are all around this idea of this crochet coral reef. I saw that online and I've never had a chance to like travel to one in exhibition. It's still on the bucket list, but I saw it and was like, that's so cool because I love the shapes. Like those shapes really tickle my brain in a very interesting way. And so I didn't set out to make coral looking things with this project. It is one of the top comments I get from people when they see the show is that they're like, oh, it looks like coral. And I'm like, you're not wrong. I mean, the influence is very strongly there, but I'm never picking my shapes because this mimics coral. The other place that it came from is that whole sensory side of the game. When I sell my art at markets, people want to pick it up and touch it because it's so tactile. And when I'm in galleries, I am that person who is like nose up against the glass because I want to see everything up close. I'm really interested in like, how is it, like, what are the component parts of this? How did those details get made? Look at how detailed these are. What was the process? Really looking at like, how is this made and getting really up close with stuff. And I'm always a little bit like sad that like, oh, you can't touch oil paintings that are in the gallery to just like feel the texture of that. Like you can't touch these things. And that's always kind of a like, oh, that's sad. I would love to hold this piece of pottery and just like feel how heavy it is. And be like, feel the shape of it and feel the way the different textures of the different glazes feel. That's something that I am just like, that would be so fun to do. And unfortunately you can't do it. And so knowing like, hey, my art tickles that desire to touch in other people that I feel just kind of all the time. And I think it would hold up to it. Like, I think I could make something that is meant to be touched, that is fine art, and kind of break that wall between the audience and the art and say, no, half the point of this exhibit is you're supposed to touch it. So those are kind of the two ideas that form what would be the sensory sculpture garden, is wanting to make art I could touch and also being really intrigued by all these shapes that were coming out of the crochet coral reef.
Definitely. And that's what sets your work so apart, is that the viewers are able to touch it and engage with it in a very different way, which Lydia's work has been at the Pump House for a week or so, and there's already been such excitement around being able to touch artwork, because you're correct, in many, pretty much every single museum setting, that's the one rule, is you can't touch the art. So it's breaking a barrier, which is exciting for everyone. So let's get into a few pieces that are in the show. This is the first piece, Reach. Could you discuss your process behind making the sculpture shape and the crochet techniques you used?
Yeah. What's interesting is I think this is maybe the first sculpture that I started. It's definitely not the first one that I finished. But it is that, no, it's not the first one I started either. Gateway is the first one that I started. This is the second one that I started. So it like had, I think, the longest stretching out of the creation process, because this is the one that I made in collaboration with people from the community. So the center of this armature is PVC piping, which I cut to be the shapes that I wanted, found all the joints that would give it the angles I wanted. I really wanted something that was exploring 3D space, but that wasn't like super heavy, that wasn't going to be like overhead, that was like very much within arm's reach. And I also was really interested in playing with texture and saying, hey, if I'm going to make like three arms, if I'm going to have things branching out, what if I had distinct textures on each arm and then I combine them going down? What if I played with it like that? It's easier for me to think about organizationally and to plan, and also would be an interesting design challenge to figure out how can I pull that off. Now this one was made in collaboration with two different groups of people. I held over the summer of 2023 when I was creating these, most of these sculptures were made during the summer of 2023. And I had my armature and I carried it with me to four different like community workshops where people helped me make all the tassels that make up that furry arm that's sticking out there, the very fuzzy one. So I went to Possibilities in Rochester for two different sessions with their Art Abilities program. So they're working with individuals in the community who are interested in pursuing and creating art, but have certain physical or developmental differences where they're not able to do that in the same ways as their able-bodied and neurotypical peers like myself. And so I reached out to the director of that program when I was beginning this project and said, hey, I'm working on this sculpture and I would love to show up in your space and invite these people to work on it with me. I think it would be interesting. And I really wanted to work with that community because part of the genesis behind the sensory sculpture garden, or I should say part of the target audience that I was specifically thinking about with the sensory sculpture garden, was folks whose processing of the world and their experience is not as like neurotypical visual first as neurotypical humans like myself, for people who like kinetic processing, kinetic learning is really important, or for people with limited vision or who are neurodivergent and intake information best when they can be hands-on and touch and like have contact and things like that, or for whom like that tickles a part of their brains in a really interesting way that just looking at a picture is not going to. And so I knew like, hey, there's people who are in the not neurotypical category who are here and doing art. And I would love to come and do art with them and see what they're working on and talk to them about their experiences and invite them to work on this with me. And it was a way for me to kind of like test drive the idea as well, because I wasn't sure initially if it was going to be as interesting to other people as it was to me. I thought the idea of like art you can touch, that sounds so cool. And I was like, I don't know if anyone else is going to agree with me. And they really agreed with me and they loved the idea. And so I worked with them for two different days to just make these tassels. And so they would cut them and tie them with me. And then I would later go back and sew them all along that arm. So that arm is just hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of tassels that I've individually stitched in there. And I did two more workshops like that at a art organization in rural Southeast Minnesota in Fillmore County, Dreammakers, because I know the woman who runs that organization. And I reached out to her and said, hey, I want to do some art making pop-ups. Could I come and do them at your farm when you have your summer pizza nights? Because I know they're super well attended. It could be an activity for people to do. And I'm just looking for a space where I can have an audience who I can invite to make tassels with me. So I brought the sculpture out there for two or three nights as well in the summer. And people made more tassels and I sewed those on. So I would say like easily 80% of the tassels on that were made by other people. The rest of it was all hand stitched by myself. But I really wanted to like have a way that the community could be involved in the making of it as well. And that was the one where I was like, no one needs to have any skills to be able to help me with this. They can just do it. And then the rest of it is all, I mean, there's so much individual hand stitching that goes into each of these sculptures. Every single tassel I'm like sewing on individually. All of those buttons are being sewed on individually. All of those little suction cup shapes are being sewn on individually. And they were all different textures that I picked because I wasn't sure if I was going to be able to use them in other spaces. Like I really wanted something very furry. And I knew I wasn't going to be able to get that in any of the projects that I was, the other pieces I was planning. So I figured this would be a good space to like have a concentrated section. And I love buttons. I think they're very cool. And I love the texture of different buttons, of like plastic ones, wooden ones, metal ones, old ones, shell ones. And like, I liked that. And I like almost the kind of like tinkling sound that they make when you have a whole bunch of them. And so I knew I wanted to do that, but I also knew like, if you want to have a big mass of buttons, that's going to be a weight issue. How are you going to get that all concentrated in one space? So that felt like a very natural inclusion here. And then the suction cups are just there because I love them. Like, I love that shape. It's so fun to like stick your fingers in the holes. They're just very fun. They're very colorful. And I was like, I can make these easily and just cover the rest of this with all of those suction cups. So that was kind of the idea behind this, is saying, what if I explore three very different textures and then bring them all together? And I wanted to explore something that was a little more unfamiliar in shape, something that was a really challenging shape. This was definitely the most challenging shape of the initial run. Just trying to figure out how to like cover those arms with the yarn sleeve that I could sew everything to, how to keep it from coming apart, how to make sure like it will hold up to people touching it, things like that.
Great. Well, thank you so much for the story behind that and the collaborative aspect behind that. And of course, the information about, how different people see the world and connect with things. And that's another just exciting aspect of this exhibition. This is a favorite of people who have visited the gallery so far. Hold. This is just one side of it. There are many different colors and textures and things. Could you give us a background on the creation of this piece and specifically how long it took you to crochet all of those individual areas and then stitch them on?
Yeah. So Hold is like my precious little newborn baby that I just barely finished this summer. It was like my big passion project for all of, I think, July. I already can't remember what month I wrote down, but I think it was July is when I was like, that was the only thing I was working on, really. So Hold, oh, the idea for this one, I just wanted something that was floating in the air. I thought that would be such a challenging, like, such a different shape than anything I've ever done before. Such a different anything than anything I've ever done before. It sounded like a cool, interesting challenge to try and figure out how could I do that. So I knew I wanted something round. And I had seen when I was doing my initial building of sculptures back in 2023, I'm going to get a little technical here, just a teeny bit for crochet nerds. I saw pictures on the internet. People were posting in a crochet group that I'm in about making wiggle mats, which are just like thick rugs with this like wiggly texture to them. And it's made using a technique called the wiggle stitch in crochet. And it's very easy, but it's such an interesting texture. People use it a lot for like pot holders, is what I was seeing, a lot of rugs and pot holders. And I said, I love that really thick feel. And I love the wiggliness of that. That's so random and weird and abstract and seems so interesting. I don't want to make a rug and I don't want to make a pot holder. I really want to put that in a big old sculpture. And I sat on that idea back in 2023 because I knew I don't have the skills and I don't have the time to make something the way I want it to be. So I actually started it this summer because I finally felt like I have the time, I have the resources, and I have all the materials that I think I need to tackle this one and see if I can pull it off. So this sculpture took me, this is the only one that I timed the creation process because I wanted to know how many hours went into this. And because people would ask me, like, how long did it take you to make this? And I would also get asked how much yarn went into this. And I would always say, I have no idea. So with this one, I was using material that I could actually measure as I was using it because it was brand new stuff. So it still had the labels on it so I could tell the yardage. So this sculpture comes in at a whopping 100 hours of construction time, 87 of which are spent just doing the surface crochet that you see all over there. I spent 87 hours doing that.
Wow, so impressive.
And it used over 7 miles of yarn, which, when I think about it, actually feels like a small number. And then I start breaking down how many yards that is. And I'm like, no, that's a lot.
Yeah,
That's a
well, it's
lot. That's a
very
real.
dense, the texture on the surface, all of the yarn is very dense, close together. I mean, it's a true just ball of amazing fluff.
Yes. It is. So yeah, that's how long this one took. And it was definitely this one I pulled it on a, I leaned on a lot of my art mentors for this one as well. One of my artist mentors, Michelle de la Vega, who lives here in rural Southeast Minnesota and was a mentor for me on the initial run of making sculptures for this series. I touched base with her and her partner to be like her partner Jeff to say, how can I build like the mold that I need for this to support the amount of weight, to support how it's built? So they kind of helped me game out a way to do that. So the inside of this ball, the inside of this sculpture is a big old beach ball that I cut a hole in and I filled it with spray foam insulation and crumpled up newspaper.
That makes
And then I
sense why it's
shoved.
so soft still.
Yeah, it's not really heavy, which I was shocked when I finished. It's not even 15 pounds. Which, I mean, it's heavy, but it's not that heavy. And
Yeah.
I was shocked that it turned out that light. But yeah, this one was a really fun project to dream up and to see begin to come together. Definitely the last like 10, 15, 20 hours of crocheting drug on. I was so ready to be done. But it was just wonderful to see it to come together and to be able to use like yarns that I wasn't going to be able to use in other places and play with color and play with a lot of those like fuzzy yarns, those specialty yarns as well, which a lot of the times I'm just using a little dib dab here and a little dib dab there. And here I was able to just be like, here's a huge patch of this just fuzzy fur. So that was really fun to do with this one. And I'm so excited to see this picture because I've never gotten a chance to see, I haven't gotten down to see the show installed yet. And I'm so excited to see it hung in a gallery. I'm really excited to go and give it a big hug in this space
Yes,
because it looks amazing.
it's an instinct. I mean, it's called hold for a reason. Everyone
Yes.
who's come in, they either automatically give it a hug or sit underneath it and hold it up. And so it's just so fun to see people interacting with art in the gallery in a different way and in such a tactile way. And specifically this one, I mean, it's at the perfect height for pretty much everyone to hold and hug or be a part of it in some way. So
Perfect.
it's been so fun to have in the galleries. Well, let's move on. This is your next piece, Geode. Could you discuss a little bit about this piece? And I'm specifically curious about you're making art to be touched by people. Are there any specific things or ways you attach the yarn to the structural piece to keep it intact and sturdy for multiple people interacting with it in such a tactile way?
Yeah. So Geode is the other one of my 2024 sculpture babies. I birthed two this year, which was so much, but I'm really glad that I got them both done. This one definitely, I had to spend a lot of time thinking about like how are people going to interact with this and will it be secure enough? Because it's all mounted on what is actually just fabric that I cut out of a roll of landscaping material, like that, just the like twine looking woven stuff that you lay down on the ground. So that material in and of itself is not very secure. But what I end up doing is after I make each piece, the long tails that are left of the yarn that I was working with, like where I cut off my ends, instead of weaving them back into the little color element, I use those to sew it in. And I sometimes reinforce it with like regular sewing thread. But every single one of those is like hand stitched in and hand stitched to each other so that it all kind of forms this like solid surface. And I spend a lot of time thinking about what textures are most durable, which textures are most likely to not hold up to prolonged contact. So if I have yarns that are really fragile and tend to unravel a lot, maybe I don't use those to make like fringes. Maybe I work those into something else so they don't get, they're supported by other fibers. And I mean, I think there's an element too of having made art that is intended for use, basically, intended for interaction and for contact. To kind of know at some point I'll need to do some repairs probably. And I've done that on some of my sculptures already, I've gone in and said, oh, this thing got like ripped and got torn a little bit. I'll sew it back in. Oh, this needs some reinforcement here. It needs some reinforcement there. Oh, I need to put a new screw in this because it's coming loose. And I think geode's only been shown in one other location. And I'm already kind of thinking about ways to potentially reinforce it a little bit more to say, here, let me make it so that it feels more like you can touch it in different ways than you ordinarily would. But the idea behind this piece, and this is one of my most challenging shapes. I did not think it would be, but it's one of my most challenging shapes because it is like a domed figure eight. And so these domes here, it was a big challenge to figure out how to make them hold their shape, especially once I started adding weight on top of it. So she got a saggy belly, but we love her anyway. But this one was a really fun, like color mapping project. I've only done one other project, Wonderwall, which is not exhibited here because it has gone to a permanent home in a collector's home. But Wonderwall is a big 5 by 5 foot tapestry that I made, which is all different textures, but they're organized by color, which is a little similar to this one. Which is really fun for me because then I get to play with like what are different textures without worrying about is it too busy because of all the colors that are there. So being able to focus on the textures are where it's different. The colors are, pretty concentrated, which is kind of where the name geode came from as well. The idea for the arrangement came from thinking about like if you crack open a geode, you see those stripes of color and saying, I want to try and recreate that free-handed with just all of these different shades of pink and orange and teal, which I don't get to use as much of in my other projects. So saying I get to bust open those boxes and use all of those textures. So
Great.
that
Yeah,
was a really fun color project.
and because the sculpture does come out and it does have a dome shape, you can see slightly at the bottom of the photo that the yarn creates shadows on the wall, which is just also exciting to see the tassels and swirls creating shadows, which is just another fun way to interact with the art. So thank you so much for giving us a background on it. Everyone should come. This is another piece in the show. Everyone should come to the artist reception on October 4th. Lydia will be there and you can touch and experience this artwork with us. Also not listed on this site, but Lydia will be teaching a class here on the pump at the Pump House on October 19th to create perfect your own little sensory crochet art pieces with buttons and different types of yarn. So if you're interested in learning any of the techniques that Lydia uses, definitely sign up for that on our website. Lydia, before we leave, is there anything that you would like people to keep in mind when viewing your work in person?
I think just give yourself permission to touch what interests you and to find whatever is interesting about it interesting. Take pictures. Hug whatever you want to hug, really.
Great. Well, thank you so much for joining me today, Lydia. Thank you, everyone, for watching.